I watched him for 15 years, sitting in a room, staring at a wall, not seeing the wall, looking past the wall, looking at this night, inhumanly patient, waiting for some secret, silent alarm to trigger him off. Death has come to your little town, Sheriff. Okay, I can't do a Donald Pleasance impression, sorry for not even trying, so I guess we'll have to go Rob Zombie on this one. His eyes will deceive you. They will destroy you. They will take from you your innocence, your pride, and eventually your soul. These eyes do not see what you and I see. Behind these eyes, one finds only blackness, the abstract of light. These are the eyes of a psychopath. Okay, that sounded more like a drunk Jeremy Irons trying to be a drunk Malcolm McDowell, but hey, impersonations are done. Now time for my own annoying voice. October is upon us once again, and I'll be taking a little bit of a break from the Reader's History of Cloak and Dagger. I know, that means it'll be like a full month before I get back to it, but hey, at least I'm not just re-uploading Ash vs. the Archivist. Those are going to be on Mondays. If you can't tell by the title of this, I'll be giving a read of one of the most, well, I don't want to say beloved, because only really the first one from 1978 is considered truly great. Except for us intellectuals, who knows that the fourth one was actually really good and would have been truly brilliant if they didn't balk at the obvious sequel. Yeah, I think anyone who's actually dug into these films know that Mustafa Akkad kind of screwed the pooch on that. But I'm not here to talk about the movies. If you want to see some fantastic and hilarious reviews of the films, then check out The Cinema Snob or Dr. Wolfula, and depending on when this comes out, or it'll be there retroactively, when FSD Productions gets their video out on the Halloween 5 ending, that'll also be linked below, and links for all the popular people are down in the descriptions. But if you prefer to just go into this dry, then close the windows, lock the doors, and let the eerie creak echo as we open the archives for the Reader's History of Halloween, the Chaos Comics era.
Remember, girls, show the world. Let them know it's Halloween.
While the Halloween franchise isn't something that needs to be explained, I think Chaos Comics does need some explanation. It came out in 1994 along with many other indie studios at the time. For reference, think about how many indie comic studios there are now, except they all created their own studio to try and capitalize on the boom of the era. So basically it's like today's market, except without the ease of digital sales to stop from truly exploding. Now, most of Chaos Comics' catalog, people will recognize from either Devil's Due or Dynamite Comics, though Lady Death is its own can of worms. They also did some comics for bands like Megadeth, The Insane Clown Posse, and Static X, but we are looking at their Halloween license with Halloween Number 1. Yeah, I know, that's a totally catchy title. I get that movie stills are cheap covers, but come on, can we do a little bit better? Okay, I think that one works. I mean, it at least glows in the dark. Yes, my inner child still likes gimmicky covers. You should truly see my old holofoil cover collection. Okay. Eventually, I will actually have to get into this comic, and you'll see why maybe it's not the best thing in the world to talk about. Written mainly by Phil Nutman, with story influenced by Daniel Ferrand, this is Halloween Number 1. We open with Tommy Doyle, seen here getting a call about Dr. Sam Loomis's old notes and files. He's definitely not being drawn to be Paul Rudd anymore, and yes, we're at that early 2000s indie artwork that I'm not really a fan of, since there's basically like three character models and like four different types of hair. But character select B on the other end of the phone is going over the Loomis notes, and we get some classic quotables from the original movie. You ever see Michael's eyes? He's got lifeless eyes. Black eyes. Like Dull's eyes. When he comes at ya, doesn't seem to be alive. Okay, I may have paraphrased there. Either way, player 2 gets offed and we get a close-up of Michael's devil eyes. But on his way out of the dude's house, by the way, the dude is actually named Cyphers, because of course it is, Michael picks up a picture of his sister Judith after he had killed her. And we have a flashback to Haddonfield, 1963, the night that 8-year-old Michael killed his sister, or was a 7-year-old Michael. But in the present, Tommy Doyle arrives to get the Loomis files from the now-dead Michael Cyphers, but apparently Michael Myers really cleaned up everything very well and didn't get a single drop of blood anywhere else. As Tommy enters the room, gets hassled by some security guard, and they leave together. All the while, Michael looks on, which I actually really dig, but then you get kill art like this, and any spine-tingling panels just fades into the background. Anyways, we then come to Tommy Doyle's house, where he's smoking a cigar and reading Loomis's notes, which actually seem to be more a journal, but hey, a man can keep a diary if he wants. And then we hop to a flashback through his journal, back to Smith's Grove all those years ago, where Dr. Sam Loomis, here looking more like he's being played by Michael Ironside, argues with Dr. Carpenter,
hi, get it,
about Michael needing his own room. Nope. The 7-year-old is instead placed in the juvenile ward with a bunch of teens. And we get to know them all by this helpful little cheat sheet. But honestly, they aren't actually important. Sorry. During the day, Loomis does try what he can to help Michael, but Michael remains silent, though does kind of convey his thoughts in other ways. While at night, O'Malley, the psychopath, because of course, tries to make Michael cry like a little girl. For his troubles, though, O'Malley gets a crayon in the eye. However, the whole thing is pinned on someone else, which means that Dr. Carpenter is still against Michael being placed in his own room. But what's this? Dr. Loomis has a love interest in a like-minded doctor, Dr. Jennifer Hill. But Michael still never leaves his mind. Really horrible jokes aside, it's Michael's birthday. But eating disorder guy Wade decides to steal all of Michael's cake. So, Michael cooks his bacon in the showers. The flashback, however, gets interrupted by Tommy getting a phone call. But when no one's on the other end, he decides to go, "It's just my imagination." There's an audible click even drawn there. But being a cautious guy obsessed with a serial killer, he shrugs it off as nothing and goes back to reading, even as the shape just stands there. Back in the journal, Dr. Carpenter decides that Smith's Grove needs a co-ed Halloween party for the kids. And someone decided that Michael should totally be in a clown outfit? The hell, guys! So place your bets on what's gonna happen to the girl who said that Michael had cooties. God from above has a random lightning strike kill the lights so she can go belly up while bobbing for apples, in kind of a suggestively drawn way. Sam Loomis has a logical answer to beat the hell out of Michael to get him to answer for his crimes, but Jennifer stops him, rationalizing that clearly the girl slipped in the dark and it was an accident. She's mainly focused about their marriage and letting Loomis retire so that they can have a nice life. And that is when Loomis decides to go for a walk to clear his head. In a time when he's totally spazzing out about Michael killing so many people already in custody, he decides to go for a walk. And that, of course, spells disaster for the woman he just left. And yeah, Dr. Carpenter sweeps Dr. Hill's death away as a suicide, and decides that he wants to move Michael to an open facility with less security. However, we get pulled out of the journal again as, at the stroke of midnight, the shape bursts through Tommy's door. Apparently, we're just gonna keep some continuity from Halloween 6, since Tommy's yelling about how he totally killed Michael before, though not entirely sure how true that statement is in any cut of that film. Tommy tries shooting Michael, which fails, and leads to a Michael Myers pimp smack. Oh, that is totally going into my holiday meme folder, and I suggest y'all take the screen grab too. Tommy counters with a Jack bottle to Michael's face, and then lights him on fire. Michael is hit through a window, but of course when Tommy goes to look out the window, there is no body. He swears a vendetta to kill Michael. And next Halloween, it got a sequel. No, not a second issue, but Halloween 2, The Blackest Eyes, which is basically just issue 2 of the story thus far. And like every Halloween 2, we start directly after the last one, with Tommy staring out of the broken window swearing revenge and sweet Christmas. He's apparently taken some steroids in the seconds before reaching the window. But enough about Tommy's hunt for Michael, let's cut to Richie Castle as he sits in his car staring at the old Myers place. Don't remember Richie Castle? Well, that's alright, he's one of the clones of young Tommy Doyle here, picking on Tommy. More specifically, he's the one that gets stopped by Michael when they run off after going, "Boogeyman, boogeyman." Apparently, that coupled with the fact that his life has been fairly terrible has led him to decide to burn down the old Myers place. Except someone else is in there, and there's a scream and gunshots. Yeah, apparently Sheriff Brackett, who lost his daughter Annie in the first movie, has been camping out waiting for Myers to come back home and just murdered the wrong person. You just can't do a Halloween sequel without someone being Ben Tramered. Yeah, that's a verb now, thanks Cinema Snob. As the sheriff carries the body to his car to dispose of it, Tommy arrives, but before he fires, because the sheriff looks a lot like Michael in the shadows there, he realizes that it's Sheriff Brackett. No, I'm not sure how he figured it out either, since the art does keep the sheriff in the same shape-like style. Oh, and while that happens, Michael is just there, watching like the creepiest of creepers, but doing nothing. So Tommy follows Brackett to a pumpkin patch where he's gonna bury Richie's body, and that's when Tommy learns that the sheriff killed Richie. However, now we get into some new stuff that fans of the franchise might actually go, huh, neat, too. So, the town is cursed because of course it is, and more importantly, the Myers bloodline is also cursed. The women in the family get visions, or can even read minds sometime, while the firstborn male becomes a serial killer to slaughter in the name of Samhain. Samhain. Sorry. Michael specifically was born 3 minutes before Halloween, a stillborn, but before he could be incinerated, because apparently that's how that works, evil spirits entered him, and he was pronounced alive at 12:06 on Halloween Day. Actually, he was a perfectly normal kid up until the day he killed Judith, who was also apparently the town's bicycle. How does Brackett know all of this? Well, the Judith stuff is because he grew up in the town, but more importantly, he has Sam Loomis's private diaries. But before any more can be exposited, Tommy and Sheriff Brackett are attacked by druids. Is this actually the Cult of Thorns, or... Of course, they're held up in a creepy church, but the priest who runs the church decides he's not up for the sacrifices on Samhain anymore. That means he needs to be shanked by the shape. Tommy then hits Michael with a chair. Brackett lights his hair on fire, getting stabbed for his troubles. Tommy shoves Michael into a random power conduit, shocking him and exploding the church. Of course, everything is pinned on Tommy by the druids. But once again, he swears revenge on Michael at the end. You'd think he'd be more pissed at the Cult of Thorns or whoever those hooded figures are. So that leads us to Halloween 3, The Devil's Eyes. Or at least I think it does, because it starts with a dream from Tommy about the events of the first movie, except Michael kills Laurie in it. Tommy wakes up in Smith's Grove as a patient. He brings up that he knows Michael is still alive, even if the news says that Laurie Strode killed him. Yeah, this is actually set a year after Halloween H2O, 20 years later, whatever the actual name of that movie is. And it's the official bridge that Daniel Ferrand wanted to do for his concept for Halloween Resurrection. But then again, Dr. Wynn is still the head of Smith's Grove in this, so does that mean that Halloween 6 never happened? I assume so in this timeline, but who knows or honestly cares. What we should care about is that Tommy escapes Smith's Grove, along with several other crazies, and also random, see, Michael is alive moment while he's escaping in a random car. Smash cut to Lindsay Wallace, the little girl from the first Halloween movie, coming back to Haddonfield after becoming a big-time journalist to tell the true story of Michael Myers. Here's where we learn Laurie's been missing for the past year, right after she beheaded Michael in Halloween H2O. Spoilers. After all the backstory to catch Lindsay and the audience up on whatever has happened in the last two issues, Tommy comes by to see her. They read some of Loomis's diaries to catch everyone up on that part, but then there's a noise upstairs. And hey, a scene that actually feels like a Halloween movie. Yeah, it's because it's a retread from the original, but hey, that's how you do it. Make it bigger and better. So what's better than the three corpses of the main guys from the first one? And Michael lunges from the dark. He stabs Tommy and begins chasing Lindsay. And a few homages later, as Lindsay falls down the stairs and with a hurt leg runs through the street screaming for help, eventually she runs to the Myers house and says screw it, she's been running enough. Which sort of annoys me since she was basically just introduced. So Lindsay goes inside and brushes her hair back and confronts Michael. But Michael doesn't take the almost Friday the 13th part 2 ending homage and smashes Lindsay into a mirror. But Lindsay gets a chance to shove a shard of glass in Michael's eye. Tommy comes in and shoots Michael. This time they also unmask him, but it's not a him. It's been Laurie Strode this entire time. Oh, they do get into the why after Laurie and Tommy go tumbling out of a window, and she winds up in Smith's Grove, and I think Tommy's dead. You'll see. Apparently, after she decapitated her brother, Laurie's obsession with the horrors of her brother made her begin to act like him in this personality transference. It is actually kind of a great twist that makes absolutely no sense. But we do end with Lindsay wondering if Loomis and Tommy were right in that it's not merely psychosis, but something more, something evil, that made Michael Myers who he was and who Laurie now is. All the while, Dr. Wynn looks on. I think that's what he's supposed to be doing here. And that is more or less the Halloween Resurrection we could have had. Would it have been more interesting to see? Most definitely. Especially considering what happened with the Halloween Resurrection we did get to see. While that was its own enclosed story, come back next week when we wrap up the Chaos Comics Halloween series with a totally different take on the franchise. Well, totally different in that it decided to not try and continue the movies directly. Yes, next time we're all due for one good scare. And I don't mean me releasing another video. Check down below for the links to people more popular than me, as well as all my social media stuff. If you have a suggestion, comment, or just want to give your own opinion on these comics, let me know in the comments. And please consider donating to the Patreon so I don't have to let day job 3 through 7 interrupt me and put me on a hiatus for a bit again. More than anything, though, I'm the Comic Archivist, and stay golden, Inklings!